Hello, and welcome to part two of our series of responses to Thunderf00t's Hyperloop Busted series. This series is a collaboration between myself and fellow YouTube user Libertarianist. In our last video, we examined Thunderf00t's experiment involving a vacuum tube and a marble, and showed that the comparison to firing a bullet from a gun was a gross overestimate due to the square cube law. Thunderf00t's response was far short of impressive. Rather than admit his comparison was inappropriate, he instead behaved like a petulant child, dismissing our criticism as nitpicking while hypocritically focusing on inconsequential details like the number of significant figures in our calculation. Now, before we continue, there are a few errors we'd like to correct from our previous video. First, I used a photo of the wrong bullet for the slide on the 9x19mm Parabellum. That's what the website from where I got it said it was, but according to Blurgline in the comments, the real 9mm round doesn't have a necked case. This is more likely a 357 SIG. The internet lied to me! Of course, this doesn't affect the calculations we performed. The specifications given were still accurate, only the image was wrong. The second was just misspeaking on my part. I mentioned the passenger plus vehicle capsule has an overall mass of 26,000 kilograms when fully loaded with fuel, passengers, and luggage. Technically, the Hyperloop runs on batteries, not fuel. The error is only semantic and doesn't affect our calculation, but still, the last thing we want to do when correcting someone else's errors is make errors of our own, no matter how small. There's enough bogosity in the world as it is without us adding more. Third, according to Thunderf00t, my calculation for the bullet's acceleration had a few too many significant figures. Libertarianist agrees that technically the proper thing to do in presenting a calculation like this is to round the figure to the same number of significant digits as the data from which the final figure is derived. So according to them, instead of giving a figure of 580,644, I should have rounded it to 581,000. And of course, Thunderf00t felt that this was worth mocking us over. And we are the nitpickers? Talk about hypocrisy. Libertarianist and I disagree on this. The figures I gave aren't estimates. They're what Beretta designed the gun to be. Beretta manufactures its parts to within a tolerance of 1 micron, which is 1/1000 of a millimeter, and any variation in muzzle velocity is going to adversely affect accuracy. And the accuracy of the 92S is one reason why it's so widely used, so I maintain that 6 digits of precision is not out of the way. Libertarianist contends that the figure we used for muzzle velocity is only precise to 3 significant figures, and therefore so should our final figure. Either way, the figure is correct for all intents and purposes, and laughably, Thunderf00t is mocking us for being too precise. Sheesh. Okay, with that out of the way, let's move to Thunderf00t's second video on the subject.
The first real challenge is simply the near impossible goal of building a 600 kilometer long vacuum chamber.
He begins by making several references to the Hyperloop running in a vacuum tube. This is incorrect. It's not a vacuum, just very low air pressure. Now that sounds like a nitpick, and I wasn't going to say anything about it, except he goes on to make a pretty big deal out of it.
So let's compare that to the world's largest vacuum chamber, shall we? Which is about 1/50th of the volume.
This is NASA's Space Power Facility near Cleveland, Ohio, and it is the world's biggest vacuum chamber. It's used to test spacecraft in the conditions of outer space.
Yeah, that's the vacuum chamber that NASA uses to test their spacecraft in, and it's 50 times smaller than the smaller version of the Hyperloop.
Of course, the Hyperloop will not need to be a vacuum. In fact, it can't be, because the Hyperloop cars hover by riding on an air cushion. Page 24 of the PDF file explains. The expected pressure inside the tube will be maintained around 0.015 psi, which is about 1/6 the pressure on Mars, or 1/1000th the pressure on Earth. This low pressure minimizes the drag force on the capsule while maintaining the relative ease of pumping out the air from the tube. The efficiency of industrial vacuum pumps decreases exponentially as the pressure is reduced, so further benefits from reducing the tube pressure would be offset by increased pumping complexity. The pressure would be somewhere around 100 pascals, and so they can eliminate the difficulty inherent in maintaining a high vacuum. The vacuum pumps would easily be able to maintain this pressure despite the presence of small leaks along the length of the tube.
Here I have a square meter. So atmospheric pressure is equal to about 10 meters of water. So that's like 10 times this distance here. So if I were to put 10 meters on top of my 1 square meter, a cubic meter of water weighs about a ton. So 10 cubic meters pushing down on one square meter would give you a pressure of 10 tons pushing down on this square meter.
This is very dramatic, but it's also somewhat misleading. While his figures are correct, he's comparing the pressure on a flat surface with the equivalent pressure around a tube. For the same reason an arch can hold up a lot more weight than a flat structure, a circular tube is about the best way to stand up to a pressure difference. Anyone who's even vaguely familiar with material science knows this. Take a heavy object like a large book and try to hold it up with a piece of paper. Now roll the paper up and then see how much easier it is to hold up the book. Thunderf00t is making an invalid comparison. If he knows it, he's being dishonest, and if he doesn't, then he doesn't have the requisite knowledge to make this analysis in the first place. He makes a similarly misleading comparison to the World Trade Centers.
So the walls are about 2 centimeters thick, about an inch or so. Cool, so we can now do the calculations for just the steel required to make only the tube in this structure. And it turns out to be about the same mass as the steel in the World Trade Center.
He's trying to trigger your incredulity here. And not very well, I might add. The World Trade Centers were built on a budget of $3.8 billion, less than the proposed cost of the Hyperloop. If anything, this comparison just demonstrates that megascale engineering like this is practical. We start getting into the meat of his claims around 4:45, where he suggests that the Hyperloop is impractical because of thermal expansion.
Most people know that if you just have, say, bridges, you need an expansion joint in them. The overall length of the Hyperloop from the coldest day to the hottest day will vary by about 300 meters, about the length of 3 football fields. So you would need a joint about every 1/10 of a kilometer, such that in the 600 kilometer Hyperloop, you would need about 6,000 moving part vacuum seals, and a failure on any one of them could be disastrous for the people inside the Hyperloop.
So Thunderf00t claims that the Hyperloop would need expansion joints every 100 meters, and then he immediately proceeds to ridicule his own figure as impractical. The actual proposal states that, in lieu of many small expansion joints, 2 large telescoping sections would handle thermal expansion at the terminal stations. From page 6. By building a system on pylons, where the tube is not rigidly fixed at any point, you can dramatically mitigate earthquake risk and avoid the need for expansion joints. Tucked away inside each pylon, you could place 2 adjustable lateral XY dampers and 1 vertical Z damper. These would absorb the small length changes between pylons due to thermal changes, as well as long-form subtle height changes. As land slowly settles to a new position over time, the damper neutral position can be adjusted accordingly. A telescoping tube, similar to the boxy ones used to access airplanes at airports, would be needed at the end stations to address the cumulative length change of the tube. Thunderf00t addresses this by... Well, that's the thing. He doesn't address it at all. He just laughs at the idea, and it's not even clear what he's laughing at.
Now, that just blew my mind, because that really does sound like they just intend to weld all of the tubes together. That is, they haven't done even the simplest expansion calculations.
You know, it's sometimes hard to accept that this is the same guy who successfully debunked so many creationists. One of the reasons why we laugh at creationists is that they think that their armchair musings somehow trump the analysis of knowledgeable scientists who have studied the issue a lot more than they have. So why would Thunderf00t assume a team of engineers hired by one of the 100 richest people in the world are so incompetent? We're talking about a man who's revolutionized 4 whole industries with innovative engineering, and his team are some of the best aerospace engineers on the planet.
Now sure, welded tubes would be great for holding the vacuum, but it does mean that your station's going to have to move by about 3 football pitches between the hottest and coldest day.
I really don't know what Thunderf00t finds so dubious about this. Yes, the ends of the vacuum tube would move by about 300 meters, but not the entire station itself! From page 27 of the proposal. Specially designed slip joints at each station will be able to take any tube length variance due to thermal expansion. This is an ideal location for the thermal expansion joints, as the speed is much lower nearby the stations. It thus allows the tube to be smooth and welded along the high-speed gliding middle section. What's so unbelievable about that?
Plus, if you're just going to weld all of these tubes together, you're going to get massive buckling problems. Painted white or not, in the hard Californian sun, the top of these things will get hotter than the bottom. That is, the top will expand more than the bottom. And with a 500-mile-long tube, you're going to get massive buckling problems of the sort that you would get on a bimetallic strip.
This is a complete non-issue. For one, the temperature difference between the top and the bottom will be relatively small. On page 26, the proposal mentions that steel was selected as the material for the tube, and steel is an excellent thermal conductor. Second, since these forces are in the vertical direction, the length mitigates the effect. The tube's own weight would keep it straight. A vertical temperature gradient wouldn't result in anywhere near enough strain to cause buckling. Third, even if this were a significant issue, there's a simple and obvious solution. All you'd have to do is shade the tube. And in fact, on page 5 of the proposal, it is suggested that solar panels over the tube could aid in powering the Hyperloop. This would also have the effect of greatly reducing the temperature gradient the Hyperloop tube experiences due to direct sunlight. Further, Thunderf00t knows this because he made fun of the proposal at the beginning of the video. We've still got quite a bit to go, so we'll finish this second video later on. Until then, stay strong and be free.